And our first speaker, very appropriately, is Jennie Formby, who, as well as being South East Region Secretary of Unite and a member of Labour's NEC, is also on the Policy Forum and chairs the, am I right, the Economic Policy co-convener of the Economic Policy Commission. So in a way, she's one of the people who's overseeing this whole process, and therefore it's, we're very lucky to have Jennie to introduce the whole broader topic. Thanks.
Thanks very much, and I'd just like to echo the words that Annalise said, really, to thank, first of all, Oxford CLP and Stephen and his colleagues and comrades for arranging this. It's a massively important issue, and it's vital that we all have an opportunity to discuss and engage in the issue of industrial policy and economic policy. Because although we campaign very strongly on things like the NHS, and people, you know, see us campaigning every day on the NHS, to some extent, I think the population and the communities we live in already understand that we are a party that defends and fights for the NHS. But if we're not credible on the economy, and of course the backbone of an economic policy has got to be industrial strategy, then we're not going to win in 2020. I'm here really more to listen than to speak to you, because I want to hear what your ideas are. I'm going to talk a little bit about the headlines of Unite's view on what a good industrial strategy looks like. But also, as co-convener of the Economy Policy Commission, we're linked into the discussions and the people who are working on the industrial strategy, and we're also linked into the people who are leading Workplace 2020, which is also a key element and key strand of everything we're going to be talking about today. But I really want to hear people's ideas, and very shortly the Policy Commission is going to be taking evidence from people. And as well as, you know, the professors and the experts, which I'm certainly not, which is why I'm really grateful to, you know, that we've got two such distinguished panel members here today who are going to be able to give you some of the answers, hopefully. We also want to hear from trade unions and from ordinary people's experiences, because there are so many ideas out there we need to listen to. So if we look at Unite's economic policy and our industrial strategy, there are really some key themes that we look at, which is investment, the important need for support for strategic industries such as steel, public procurement, skills and training, we're talking about meaningful skills and training, and of course trade union workers' rights, both individual and collective, that from our point of view underpins everything that we do, and those are really important. So I'm just going to sort of do a very, very quick run-through of what our thinking is on that. And of course we're still working on this all the time, and in the same way as the Labour Party is taking evidence and working with other people, so is United for Union, working with lots of very, very interesting and very well qualified people on this, as well as listening to those who are absolutely at the sharp end, like our members in BMW, who've got decades of experience and also are very concerned about what's happening to our economy at the moment. So if we look at investment, of course we've got chronic problems in the UK after decades of underinvestment and a very prolonged investment strike by big business that we know has been going on for a very long time. And that's led, of course, to a stagnating economy, low growth, low productivity, and the lack of balance in our economy, and the lack of fairness in our economy as well. And when you look at who gets the benefits at the moment, it's certainly not ordinary working people and their communities and families live in those communities. So that's something that we really need to address, and it's crazy to think that after so many years of incredibly low interest rates, that the government hasn't taken the opportunity to look at how we increase borrowing and invest in areas that are going to grow and develop our economy. It's a bit of a no-brainer, but it's so much of a no-brainer that it's something they haven't done. And that's why Unite is in complete support of the idea of a national investment bank and of regional investment banks to allow proactive support, both national and the big picture issues, but also regionally and locally. So, as Annalise said so eloquently, that we can have some proper investment in our local economy, and we can have some autonomy to some extent over what happens, so that we're not sort of controlled by bigger outside forces where we have no democratic involvement or engagement. I suspect that we're going to be talking about a lot of the same themes today, but I think there's nothing wrong with us saying the same thing over and over again, because we've got to get these ideas out to people in a way that they understand. That's not dumbing it down. It's just getting people to think about the key issues and recognising it actually is accessible. It's not something that's so complicated that only clever Tories can talk about it. But it's something that actually makes a real difference to all of us, and every individual is capable of understanding it. understanding these ideas, which always, of course, brings me back to the Rabbit Trouser Philanthropists, but let's not go there for now. For those of you who've read it, you'll understand what I mean. For those of you who haven't, then please do. And, of course, that investment should be looking at support for strategic industries, not just when they're in crisis, like steel, and sort of fumbling about, but still failing to really monopolise and capitalise, if you like, on the opportunities that we had and we've now missed, to make sure that we do invest in steel, that we do look at perhaps converting some of the facilities that were going to be closed down to use for things like carbon capture and storage, which was, there was some detailed work that was put together by a whole number of researchers on how we could maintain some of the plants, maintain the jobs, look at the same time at greening our economy, but that was completely failing. But state intervention, those two words aren't dirty words, and nor are public ownership. And, you know, I'm old enough to remember the dismantling of our structures bit by bit and selling off the family silver by Thatcher. And you'll forgive me for saying that a lot of other comrades here are equally in the same position of being able to remember that. And I still remember the first day that I ever met Tony Benn many years ago when I was meeting him off a train in Southampton. Because he's come to do a talk and saying, "How do you feel today, Tony? How are you?" And he said, "I feel really depressed because it's the first time I've ever travelled on a privately owned train." But then when you look at the complete mess, and I was talking to a comrade earlier on about Southern Rail, we look at the total mess and the abject failure of the private companies to run these companies appropriately, because they're only looking at profit. And whatever anyone may think about the strike, and of course, is every effort now to turn against the trade unions, and to some extent, some of the unions are fighting amongst themselves. But nonetheless, that should be in public hands. And we only have to look at East Coast Mainline. That was in public hands till very recently. It was doing extremely well, it wasn't making a loss, it was being run efficiently, and it's an absolute scandal that it was sold. So we do really need to look at, you know, where should we be having state intervention, and where should the state be taking a stake, a golden share, if you like, so that we have a control over those decisions in those sectors that are so important to us. You know, if we don't have a thriving British steel industry, then we're dependent on Chinese steel for so many things. And whatever, you know, any of us may think of trials and so on, to think of the, you know, using Chinese steel and being dependent on it for building of subs and so on, is something I think that those of us who are interested in defence would be comfortable about. And I'm saying that because our trade union has got tens of thousands of workers in those sectors, and we're a long way away from diversification. Perhaps we shouldn't go there, because that's a big issue. So, of course, we've got to invest in our infrastructure, we've got to invest in transport, we've got to invest in communications, we've got to look at how we invest to green our economy, and of course in housing. And I guess, Stanley in Oxford, you have got one of the most horrendous housing problems here. And the fact that you've got very little public housing available for, you know, for our children and grandchildren, for future generations, and yet some of the most expensive housing stock, I just don't know how people can cope. And the answer is they can't cope, because there isn't any adequate housing here. So all of those issues are really important. And I guess that leads us on to the question of public procurement. Public procurement is something we've talked about a lot. It was something that we talked about in the Labour Party before the general election, and there was a lot of scratching of heads and people saying, well, you know, European legislation means we can't use public procurement in the way that we wanted, but it wasn't true. And at that time I was working in the political department of Unite, and we had a lot of discussions with Annalise and with her comrades in the European Parliament, and they were absolutely brilliant. They were spot on. Look, don't say that European legislation is standing in your way, because it isn't. We can get around that, but we haven't used that as a tool, really, in our armoury, and it's fantastic that we are starting to talk about that far more. You look at the public procurement budget in the UK, and this may be slightly out now, but I believe it's £200 billion a year. That's absolutely massive. And then you look at how that's been squandered, and how jobs, for example, for Bombardier, they went abroad. We closed Bombardier in Bombardier, there's thousands of jobs there. We look at things like shipbuilding and so on, but also, you know, you can answer in terms of procurement, you look at things like drugs and so on. We don't do things in the UK, it's about British, it's not about British jobs for British workers. It's about using public finance to buy and build the things that we need to boost our economy, to be particular to boost our manufacturing base, and as a result, benefiting the whole of the economy. It's a little bit of a no-brainer to think that if you provide good quality, well-paid jobs for people who are then going to pay tax and make sure that those who are providing the jobs pay tax in the UK, it's not a difficult thing to do. And although there's someone in the Labour Party who I can't say I agree with politically at all, which is John Speller, but he's been talking for years and years and years about just one issue: why don't we build police cars in the UK? Well, why don't we? You know, Germany wouldn't be, you just go to Germany and see people driving cars that are built anywhere other than Germany. Why don't we build them here? Well, we've got a fantastic automotive sector where people are very well trained, very well paid, protected with collective bargaining and so on. You know, and so we can go from sort of the local issues like that to the far bigger issues, and that's something that's massively important. But of course, procurement policies aren't just about what do we make. We can always also look at ethical issues behind procurement policies. And at a local level, for example, a number of local authorities are doing this very well. I'm sorry, I don't know enough about Oxford to know if this is something that happens here, but certainly in places like Ipswich and others. Many local authorities have become living wage employers, which means that they insist that contractors who work for them pay a living wage. And there's no reason at all why we shouldn't start examining the employment policies of those to whom we're giving these major publicly owned contracts, which are massively profitable for people. I mean, I might prefer them all to be in-house, but that's another issue. Whilst we are using public money to buy in services or goods or whatever, then let's make sure that the people who are providing them are paying at least a living wage, that they recognise trade unions and give access to trade unions to organise, that they collectively bargain with trade unions, that they've got decent policies on environmental issues. These are not things that are difficult or complicated or complex, and they do happen in a whole number of areas. And it's a massive opportunity for us, and of course, provide proper apprenticeships and training. And that brings me on to skills and training. Again, Annalise talked about skills and training and how hugely important it is. And it's one thing that's characterised far too many governments, including, unfortunately, Labour governments, although, of course, they were much better than the Tories, but there's no one worse than the Tories. They have the gall to talk about apprenticeships, yet they don't provide apprenticeships that are really worth being. The kind of apprenticeships that Unite looks at is what we call solid gold apprenticeships. These are proper training programs with people who are paid properly, who feel secure, who've got a job at the end of it, and who are going to come out of it. A bonus not just to the employers they're working for now, but a pool of labour for our economy in the future. And nowhere have we got a better example than BMW. I was absolutely blown away when I visited BMW last year and saw their apprentice training school. And if any of you have got an opportunity to go and see it, then do. You know, this massive building that's absolutely state-of-the-art, over 100 apprentices at any one time. They're all on excellent rates of pay because they're all trade union members, because it's been negotiated by the trade union, and it didn't come easily, by the way. They've been fighting for many, many years. We've got Chris, who's been the convener for decades, only just retired, together with Steve and Norman here, who are now taking Chris's place and moving on. But they were hard fought for. But it benefits BMW. It benefits our society. It benefits the local economy. Not to have people nipping off a day release every now and then and pay £2, £3, £4 an hour because that's deemed to be acceptable. But people who are paid, I think you told me when I came around, they were something like £35 a year at the end of it. So they're, is that right? Yeah, so they are paid extremely well. And what a benefit they're paying, tax, and they're contributing. And, you know, it's not rocket science for us to understand and recognise that if we don't fill these gaps, then we are going to continue to stagnate the economy. And, of course, trade union workers' rights, these are massively important. And as you would expect from a trade union, this is at the core of everything that we look at, and we believe it should be at the core of any government industrial strategy. What's wrong with saying that our economy should be built on a framework of fairness at work? You know, what's so extreme about that? And that looks at rights for workers to join a trade union, rights for workers to be represented by a trade union, to collectively bargain, which is massively important, not to be on 0 hours or precarious contracts, not to kind of think, you know, where's my next wage coming from? If they have problems at work, to have access to justice, Yesterday I had to sign off agreement that we're going to pay, as a trade union, we're going to pay for a solicitor to represent a member who has been deducted 250 quid at work. That's going to cost us 1,200 quid. Now if we win, we'll get the money back. That member would never have been able to go to a tribunal without a trade union. Because it just doesn't make sense. You know, they've got 250 quid they hope they're going to get at the end of it, but they can't afford to pay the money out to get justice. It's an utter disgrace. So it's extremely important that we have strong trade unions. And we go one step further. And we talk about sectoral collective bargaining. And some people drop their hands in horror and say, how can you possibly have collective bargaining on a sectoral basis? Well, I'm old enough to remember when I first became a trade union official nearly 30 years ago, we did have sectoral collective bargaining. We had trades councils, we had joint industrial councils. All of the major industries in the UK were governed in that way. We used to have a publicly owned transport sector. You know, road and bridge, publicly owned. It's something you kind of think, did I dream that or was it real? And, you know, maybe it wasn't managed as well as it could be. Maybe it wasn't run in the best possible way. But that means that private enterprise is the answer to that. But sectoral collective bargaining is something that's massively important because it then creates a level playing field of employment rights for employers, so they're not constantly having this race to the bottom. And Len McCluskey talked about it recently, massively misinterpreted by people when he was talking about migrant workers. And I guess it's kind of following on from what Ed Miliband's talked about in terms of how do we address the issue of migrant workers. Not how do we stop migrant workers coming here and taking our jobs and putting the blame on them, but saying how do we stop bad bosses from exploiting migrant workers and bringing them to the UK where they've only advertised in European countries and bring them here and then exploit them and shut them into these dreadful houses with 10, 15, 20 people and send them out to work only paid £3, £4, £5 an hour if they can get away with it. Of course, there's virtually no enforcement, so we can't find out this is happening. So that's why when Ed Miliband was talking about migrant workers and how we resolve this issue, he said we should make it illegal for employers to only recruit abroad and that we should enforce a living wage so that people are on a living wage and disincentivise employers from thinking that they've got a pool of labour that they can exploit. And Len McCluskey kind of developed that idea when saying this is why we should have sectoral collective bargaining, because if we have sectoral collective bargaining with trade unions at the heart of that, and trade unions at the heart of everything we do, then we're not going to be able to exploit workers. And there will be opportunities for people to work and get decent work and well-paid work. And that's massively important. It's not radical. I'm not going to talk at length about Brexit because I think we could spend probably 3 days of seminars talking about this. And I know you had an event last night where you talked about the Euro members meeting. It's obviously a massive challenge, particularly to our, and something that's very concerning to our members in the automotive industry. I mean, our headlines are tariff-free access to the single market, retention of workers' rights, the collective voice of workers to be heard at the bargaining table. I don't think I hold my breath on that at the moment. But one thing that as a trade union we're going to have to watch out for is the opportunism of employers. Mm-hmm. Because employers will be saying to us, as we've already heard from BMW and this report at our regional committee last week, they're already saying, oh, well, you know, we might have to pay 10% tariff, so we're going to have to look at how we claw that back from you. And we know that this is going to, that's just going to be the beginning of it. I saw something the other day where a pizza company in the Midlands said, you know, we're going to have to look at laying off a few workers and cutting people's pay because of Brexit. Well, how on earth is Brexit having such a direct impact on this pizza company at the moment? You know, maybe a few of their ingredients they're paying a bit more of, but it's opportunism, and that's something that we really need to watch out for. And we need to get this across to individuals, because it's not just of interest to us and to the people in that pizza factory and the people in the car factory. There is a huge feeling and a sort of sense out there in the community because we're not getting our ideas across. Well, you know, yeah, it is a real problem. It is going to cost a lot more. We've got to accept the fact that we're going to lose jobs, and perhaps we need a little bit more austerity. You know, and we've just got to get these ideas out there and get people to think about not accepting everything that's said to them by the government. Mm-hmm. And perhaps one day the BBC will stop bringing Nigel Farage on as the go-to commentator on every single thing. Their particular position. So just in summary, these aren't radical ideas that we're talking about. To look at investment in our economy, in our local infrastructure, in our key industries.
To spend money to benefit both our economy and our society, to make sure that people have got public contracts, pay their taxes, that they employ people, that we create and protect well-paid and secure jobs, that we've got a workforce that's protected. But nonetheless, although they're not complicated or difficult ideas, they're not things that we talk about enough. So I just really want to finish where I started, which is to say thank you for doing this. I think the more that we have these kind of seminars, and the more actually we get out and look at how we campaign in our communities, the better. From Unite, what we're looking at doing in the South East, our political team in the South East, are looking not just at how we, you know, go out on the doorstep and support our local Labour Party, but let's think about how we can get into local communities. Can we have, for example, kind of pretty loaded questions on a survey and say to somebody, you know, what do you think in terms of public procurement? You know, who should be doing this? Should we be building council houses? Can you afford, or can your children afford, the housing they're in? I'm sure it's not beyond our wit to think of these ideas and give us an opportunity to start having conversations with people. We've got a few people from the Unite community. They've done this really well. They've had a housing roadshow that's been out on the road, and they were asking people to put beams in a sort of thing, the sort of structure they've built, to say, what are your big concerns about housing? And it's very simple and quite crude way of getting people's attention, but they started conversations, and they had people stopping and talking to them for 10, 15, 20 minutes about these issues. And that's what, you know, we should, as a Labour Party, be doing as well. And I think there's huge opportunities ahead of us. So thank you very much.